Okay, so in this video, we will consider an example of a test of hypothesis in the case of two dependent samples. So here's the problem. 10 government employees working for the Ministry of Revenue, verifying personal income tax returns, were randomly chosen to attend a one-day conference on how to increase productivity. The following table contains the average number of income tax returns verified per day for each of the 10 employees before and after attending the conference. Because we only have 10 pairs here, we have to assume that the table entries follow a normal distribution. If we don't know this, we would have to have a sample of at least 30 employees or more, and then we could quote the central limit theorem and have the same statistic, and we'll proceed as we are going to in the assumption of normality. So we have our 10 employees. So these are the before scores and the after scores. So employee number one was averaging 9 verifications per day before the conference, 10 verifications per day after. And that's the same for the other 9 employees. So let's look at part A. We want to test at the 5% level of significance the claim that an employee will be more productive after attending the conference. Well, we know that before we even try to test this hypothesis, that somehow the conference will increase employees' productivity, we know we need two quantities. We need the sample mean difference and the sample deviation of our differences. So let's go with difference of after minus before. So the first difference will be 10 minus 9 plus 1. The second difference, 11 minus 11, 0. Third difference, 11 minus 12, negative 1. 14 minus 13, 1. 10 minus 10, 0. 11 minus 12, negative 1. 9 minus 8, positive 1. 11 minus 9, positive 2. 14 minus 15, negative 1. 9 minus 9, 0. So now we have our 10 differences for each employee. The difference between the after and the before scores. And now we can easily find our sample mean difference. Right, d bar is going to be the sum of the d values over n. So if you add those up, divide by n here, which is equal to 10, you will find a sample mean difference of exactly 0.2. So we have our d bar, and now we need to find our sample deviation for our differences. So we will sum for each difference. We will take the difference minus the average difference and square it. We'll add those up, divide by n minus 1. Since n is 10, this will be over 9, and we take the square root of this. So if you did, 1 minus 0.2 squared plus 0 minus 0.2 squared up to plus 0 minus 0.2 squared, you get this sum. Divide by 9, take the square root, and you will find that the sample deviation for our differences is approximately 1.0328. And now we're good to go. We have our sample mean difference, our sample standard deviation for the differences, so we can formulate our hypotheses. So, again, we will be under the assumption of H0. H0 is the hypothesis of no change. Therefore, that the conference had no impact on employees' productivity, so the after scores and the before scores are the same, and so the mean difference is 0. But now we're talking about the true mean difference. So mu d is equal to 0. And what is our alternate hypothesis in H1? Well, what is the claim we're trying to verify? We want to test the claim that an employee will be more productive after attending the conference. Well, if they are more productive, the after scores should be larger than the before scores. And so if we do after minus before, these should be larger. Therefore, the difference should be positive. And so H1 will claim that the true mean difference between the after and the before scores, since those are bigger, at least that's the claim, the mean difference will be bigger than 0. And you see, if you would have let the difference be before minus after, then if the after scores are bigger and you do before minus after, you would get a negative value, and so your H1 would simply become UD is less than 0. So it never matters if you go with after minus before scores or before minus after scores. All that matters is once you state your H1 that you are consistent with your choice. Okay, well, recall that we have a 5% level of significance, so alpha is 0.05. Let's look at our statistic. So we have the sample mean difference minus the true mean difference over the sample deviation over the root of n. We know this will follow approximately a t-distribution. And the degrees of freedom, we know are n minus 1. As we have 10 values, 10 differences, n minus 1 is simply 9. So we have our statistic, which follows a t-distribution with 9 degrees of freedom. We have our significance level. We can now construct our rejection region. We have the t-distribution, so let's draw our t-distribution. We know it looks a lot like the z-distribution, except it has slightly heavier tails. And now, which part of our distribution are we rejecting? Well, H1 claims that mu d is bigger than 0, so we have a right tail test, and so we reject the larger 5% of values. And recall that we have 9 degrees of freedom. And so if you use now your table for the t-distribution, then you read off the score here, the t-score, when the area above the given t-score is 5% with 9 degrees of freedom, you will find a t-score of 1.883. And so we now have our rejection region. Our region starts from 1.883 all the way up to positive infinity. Well, all we're missing now is our observed t-score. Well, our sample mean difference, we obtain 0.2, minus the true mean difference. Again, we are under the assumption of H0 that there is no difference, and so mu d is simply equal to 0, over our sample deviation for the difference, so roughly 1.0328, over the square root of n. We had n 10 values, so the root of 10. If you evaluate this, you'll find approximately an observed value of t of 0.612. And now we can reach our conclusion. Here's our rejection region, and is our t-score, our observed t-score, in or out of the rejection region? Well, clearly 0.612 is smaller than the 1.88, so our observed t-score is not in the rejection region, and so we do not reject H0, therefore we accept H0. And so if you think of it, well, what is our conclusion about this conference, which was supposed to improve productivity? Well, the evidence suggests that we should accept H0. H0 says that the mean difference between the before and after the conference is 0. So really, by accepting H0, we accept that the evidence points to the fact that the conference had no impact on employees' productivity. So, this is our conclusion. Let's look now at B. We're asking B now to construct a 98% confidence interval for the true mean difference between an employee's productivity before and after attending the conference. The true mean difference is mu D, and so we're trying to now construct a 98% confidence interval for mu D. Well, let's do so. Let's just quickly write what we have previously found. We have found a sample difference of 0.2, a sample deviation of roughly 1.0328. We have a sample of size 10 with 9 degrees of freedom. And we're trying to build a 98% confidence interval, so C is 0.98, our confidence level. And recall our statistic, the sample mean difference minus the true mean difference over the sample deviation for the difference over root of n. This was approximately a t-distribution, and the degrees of freedom we know are equal to 9. Now we're good to go. As always, when we want a confidence interval, we draw the proper distribution. So here, we draw the t-distribution. Well, we want a 98% confidence interval. So the center part of our distribution will have an area of 0.98. This leaves 2% for both tail ends. By symmetry of the t-distribution, both tail ends have an area of 1%. And recall that we have 9 degrees of freedom. So if you use your table of the t-distribution with 9 degrees of freedom, you'll find a critical t-score here of 2.821. And by symmetry, of course, this is negative 2.821. Let me double check. That's good. Now, we have a 98% confidence interval for T, right? The probability of a T random variable with 9 degrees of freedom to lie between these two values is 98%. Well, since we want a confidence interval for the true mean difference, we replace t by our statistic. So we get negative 2.821 is at most our statistic. Well, we're trying to isolate for mu d. So our first step, as always, will be to multiply across by SD over root of n. And if you notice, this is the sample difference. This is the true mean difference. And so the difference is just the error. Well, if you remember, we have our sample deviation. It was approximately 1.0328. And we have n, which is 10. So if you plug in here, you'll find an error that is approximately equal to 0.9213. That's the error. And you know that the final, the two steps are away now. I'll simply write E to save myself a bit of writing. The next step will be to subtract the sample difference. So you'll have here minus the error, minus the true mean, the sample difference is at most the negative of the true mean difference, at most the error, minus, we're subtracting across by the sample difference, and to finally isolate mu d, simply negate across the inequalities. Of course, by negating, you will reverse the inequalities. So you'll have here, and I'll write this in not as e plus d bar, but with d bar plus e. Flip the inequality, mu d, flip the inequality. If you negate this, you'll get positive d bar minus e. Of course, what we have is now is the interval, but written backwards. So let's just rewrite this in the proper direction. So you'll have d bar minus e is at most mu d, which in turn is at most d bar plus e. But we have the error right here, and if you remember, the sample mean difference was 0.2. So if you do 0.2 minus the error, 0.2 plus the error, you will obtain your 98% confidence interval for mu d. If you round both values to the second decimal place, you will find a value to the right of 1.12 and to the left of negative 0.72. And so with 98% confidence, we can claim that the true mean difference will lie between negative 0.72 and positive 1.12. And that is our confidence interval. Now, let's ask the question, is this consistent with our conclusion from part A? If you remember in part A, we accepted H0, and the claim in H0 is that the true mean difference is actually zero. Therefore, the conference had no impact on employees' productivity. Let's see if our interval is consistent with the conclusion from part A. Look at this on the real line. The left-hand point is negative, so if you draw 0, the left-hand point negative 0.72, the right-hand point 1.12. And so you see that this interval of confidence is consistent with our conclusion from part A. In part A, we concluded by saying that the evidence points to the fact that the conference did not improve productivity, and so the true mean difference was taken to be zero. So the conference had no impact on employees' productivity, and if you look here, we are 98% confident that the true mean difference will lie between these two values. Well, if you think of it, part of the interval is negative, part of the interval is positive, so we can't claim that mu is negative, right? If you think of it, our three possible claims, mu d being negative, because, well, there's a big chunk of our interval that consists of positive values. This is out. Mu d is bigger than zero is also out, because there is also a really big chunk of our interval that consists of negative values. That's also out. And because our interval seems to be almost centered around zero, it really looks like we are revolving around a difference of zero. And this is why our confidence interval supports our conclusion from part A. And that's it.